Hello and welcome to the Drexel interview. I'm your host, Paula Marantz Cohen, speaking to you from my office as Dean of the Pennoni Honors College at Drexel University in Philadelphia. Today my guest is the eminent historian, Gordon S. Wood. Dr. Wood is the Alva O. Way University Professor of History Emeritus at Brown University and the author of some 20 books dealing with the American Revolution and its context. He is the recipient of numerous awards and honors, including the 2010 National Humanities Medal and the Pulitzer Prize for the Radicalism of the American Revolution. His latest book is Friends Divided, John Adams and Thomas Jefferson. Gordon Wood, welcome to the Drexel interview.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here.
As a historian, you could have written about many subjects, and yet you have focused your career on the period of the American Revolution. And I'm wondering what it is that drew you to this period and kept you so focused on it over the course of many, many years.
Well, in graduate school, I became convinced that the American Revolution was the most important event in American history, bar none, and that I wanted to write about that event and learn about it. It really is what defines us as Americans. What the ideals coming out of the Revolution are really the only thing that hold us together, because we're not a single people. There's no American ethnicity. So to be an American is to believe in something, and what we believe in are the ideals of the American Revolution. So it just makes sense to study that event.
I want to get to those ideals, but first I want to ask you whether, because it certainly has drawn you over the course of 50 years, I suppose, mm-hmm. as a scholar and writer, whether there was any research discovery over the course of that career that changed your perspective, that you could say caused a sea change in you.
Yes, I trained with Bernard Balin at Harvard, and his book on the ideological origins of the revolution, I think, was a revolutionary book itself. It really did change, I think, the historiography, that is the history writing about the revolution. And I was a student when that book came out, and that convinced me that this was the event to study. His contribution, it's 50 years when it was first published, 1967, and we're celebrating the jubilee of that book.
And what was it? What was the nugget in that book?
Conception, it was called The Ideological Origins of the Revolution, and he showed how the revolution occurred intellectually and the consequences, intellectual consequences of that, of the revolution. And that was enough to convince me to study it.
So the ideas, in
right,
other words,
exactly.
The ideas that propelled our founders.
Right, right.
Now tell me something else. I mean, your first book was in the late 60s, and that was a period of turmoil in American life. And I wonder if that affected your view, and if at various points along the way, because you've written a book every few years, whether the context within which you were writing, starting in the late 60s, shaped the way you were writing about the founders.
I don't think so.
But you're not sure.
Well, of course, you're never sure how much the present is impinging on your consciousness. I thought I was living in the 18th century and not in the 1960s. I mean, I was aware of the Vietnam War. I was aware of all that was going on. But I don't think I brought that into the work that I was studying the constitution making of the revolution, the state constitution making, which was far more important in some respects than the federal constitution. But that whole period from 76 to 87 was what I was focusing on, and I didn't think I was bringing the present into that because I was very much caught up in the notion that the present should be kept away from your interpretation of the past. You really want to contextualize the past and study the past for its own sake, not to make some kind of present point.
Well, can I ask the other way then, whether in writing about the past then in particular, that affected how you looked at the present?
Yes, I suppose so. I was much more aware of the way in which our Constitution was created, and therefore it affected my attitude towards the Constitution, whether it was a living document or a dead document, as Justice Scalia said. So in that sense, I had a new awareness of constitutional issues in the present, but I still saw myself and continue to see myself as a historian who wants to understand the past for its own sake. And I'm compelled by the notion that the past is L.B. Hartley said, the past is a foreign country. They do things differently there. You start with that premise and you won't get into trouble trying to bring our present world back to judge them by our present standards.
Or vice versa.
So
do you feel that that's a particular danger of the present?
Oh, definitely. That's what the greatest danger is, anachronism. Mm. The great sin of history writing is anachronism, to bring the present into the past and to interpret the past in terms of the present. You've missed the point of what the past is. It's like going to a foreign country and scolding them for not being like us. And anyone with any sensitivity knows that that's not what you do when you go to France or Italy or China. You don't go there and say, well, why don't they have what we have? Well, why do they behave that way? That would be strange.
And yet Americans have, not now, but traditionally been accused of doing that.
Well, we're not a very historically minded people.
Interesting.
Actually, I think, compared to, say, Britain, the former mother country. I think it was President Polk said, the United States is the only country that has its history in the future.
I love that quote.
Well, that's the way 19th century Americans thought of it. The past was to be bulldozed over. And
I think that's still very much in the climate of the moment.
I think we are, in that sense, I think we're not a very historically minded people in the way some European countries are.
Well, I want to talk about your latest book, Friends Divided, John Adams and Thomas Jefferson. And I loved this book. And I was also frustrated by it, as I think I would be by these two extraordinary men. They were complex, difficult people in some ways. I don't know if you'd say Jefferson was difficult, but he was certainly complex. And I feel you struggled with this in representing them. And I wonder if you could start by just giving us a sketch of each one of their personalities as you see it.
Well, they couldn't be more different from one another, both physically, as you know, Jefferson's 6'2 or so, gangly. Adams is, by contrast, he's stout. He's maybe 5'6", a very ordinary looking man, he said of himself. So physically they differ, but more important, they differ in every important matter, in their ideas of government, in their ideas of human nature, in their sense of what America was, in their view of religion. I can't think of any issue where they didn't differ, and they differ as much as two people could differ from one another. Now, the only thing they did have in common is, of course, support for the Revolution and love of their country. They also hated Alexander Hamilton.
I was going to ask you about that.
So that gave them something in common. Both of them hated that man with a passion.
And why did they hate Hamilton? Now, well, I ask you this with Hamilton being on ascendant at the moment.
Right, of course, because he's of the show and so on. But they hated him because, well, Jefferson couldn't differ more in his attitude towards government. Hamilton was a big government man, big Pentagon, a big army, navy, a fiscal military state, a European-type state is what he wanted to build here. And Jefferson, of course, wanted a very different kind of state, a minimal state. That was the progressive position in the late 18th century. That is the small government. Get the monarch out of the way and let people's natural love for one another circulate. Adams hated him, even though they were members of the same party, because Hamilton turned on him and ridiculed him and actually wrote a pamphlet in 1800 that was devastating against the man who was supposed to be the Federalist, that is, the party candidate. Hamilton wrote this very devastating pamphlet. And
even though their views were somewhat coincident.
Adams was never a Hamilton-type Federalist.
Yeah.
He certainly was not a Jeffersonian. But he never was one for big government, just on its own sake. He didn't want a big army. He was a Navy man, but neither was he a small government man. So he just was, he was a Federalist. He believed in law and order and hierarchy, social hierarchy, inequality, all of these Federalist things. But he didn't share Hamilton's view of
epistemology. Was he a monarchist?
Well, that's too strong. He certainly, at one point, writes and says, look, things are going to get so bad in America with elections. They're going to get so corrupt, so partisan, that we'll just have to go to lifetime appointees for the both the Senate.
Isn't it amazing that he said that?
Well, I don't know if we've reached that point yet, but he might think we have.
He might think so.
But, that we eventually have to go to hereditary president and hereditary Senate. He always wanted the House or the lower houses in the states and also in the federal government to be elected. But the Senate, his model was in the English Constitution. He wanted the Senate to be like the House of Lords and the president to be like the king, with a veto power, an absolute veto power over all legislation.
Yes, I think that's interesting. I guess he wanted Washington to continue to serve.
Well, I think the expectation when they created the presidency was that the man would serve for life, and he would die in his office, and then the vice president would take over, and he would serve. And that's why Jefferson called the presidency a Polish king, because that's how the Polish king was. He was elected by the aristocrats, and he served until he died, and then they elected another king. So he's a monarch, an elected monarch, and that's how, in many respects, that's how Adams saw the presidency. And Washington didn't follow the rules. He was desperate to get out of the office and get back to Mount Vernon. So he didn't play by the expectation. And Jefferson, of course, when he got into office in 1800, served for two terms, and he really set the precedent by retiring in 1809.
I guess so. Jefferson set the precedent, but in a way, Adams was such an important president because he affected the transition.
Well,
the
yes,
first
of course,
transition.
But he got defeated, and he was humiliated by that. I mean, he was
such a sensitive guy.
Well, he was. He was very sensitive. Yeah. He had a thin skin, even though he was constantly making fun of other people, even openly.
Yeah,
he had a sharp, sarcastic tongue.
Right.
But he was really deeply humiliated by that election. He refused to attend Jefferson's inauguration.
Right.
The only president who didn't attend his successor's inauguration.
Of course, there wasn't much of a precedent.
No. But I mean, since then, there's been no president who has not shown up. So he left on the 4 o'clock, 4 a.m. stage to get out of Washington D.C. as quickly as he could, and not have to face the humiliation of Jefferson becoming president.
Well, as you say, Jefferson could not have been more different from Adams. And I was surprised, even though I knew to some extent what an idealist Jefferson was in many ways, that his dogged support for the French Revolution, even when it had devolved into terror.
That's right.
And that, to me, was astounding. And I wonder if you could explain that.
Well, he's an ideologue, and he just felt that revolutions, Republican revolutions, were going to sweep the world, and we were the first, and we had set the pattern. He's the one who creates American exceptionalism. We're the leader. We're in the vanguard of this revolutionary movement. Began with us. The French are taking it up, and they will continue it, and it will spread everywhere. He foresaw revolutions. Well, in some sense, he's been vindicated, at least in Europe and in the developed world. Most of the states are democratic, and that's what he wanted and expected. Now, he's a radical, and he really believed. Well, at one point, his protege, his successor as minister to France, writes back to him, 1793, right in the middle of the Terror. Mr. Jefferson, many of your aristocratic friends are being guillotined by the thousands. And Jefferson writes this extraordinary letter where he says, well, if only a man, an Adam and Eve were left alive and left free, it would be worth it. It'll be better than it is now. Well, this is what led Conor Cruz O'Brien, the Irish journalist and historian, to say that Jefferson, he wrote a book on this period. And he said, Jefferson's the pot Paul of the 1990s, Pot Pol being
yes,
the Cambodian leader
absolutely.
Who was willing to kill millions on behalf of the communist cause for Cambodia. So Jefferson,
it amazes me, and especially, I mean, his hatred of the aristocracy. He was an aristocrat.
Of course.
So, this is not, I cannot comprehend this. Did he ever self-reflect?
You've heard of limousine liberals.
Yes, well. I have. So he was the ultimate limousine.
He's the ultimate limousine liberal.
But was there a self-awareness there that he would sacrifice himself if the revolution took that turn? Do you feel that? I mean, he wasn't giving up anything from the point of view of his wealth and position.
His friend James Madison said that he was subject to these kinds of outbursts of enthusiasm. Mm. There's no reason to think that he would have acted upon that kind of view, that he would have executed people by the hundreds of thousands. I don't think he was a Robespierre, but he was never put in that position to defend the revolution in that way. But he did speak like that. He feared political power. But so didn't Adams. That's what's interesting. The two of them were really fearful of power.
And yet they wanted power.
Well, they wanted
they were
to
ambitious.
Be leaders. Yes,
yeah.
They wanted to be leaders, but at the same time, they wanted to check power. And I think that's what's fascinating about them.
Well, it is interesting. I want to get to slavery, but first one more point about Jefferson. I mean, the other thing that comes through in your book is how refined and how gifted on at least a superficial way Jefferson was, as opposed to the deeper kind of, I don't know if I'm characterizing this correctly, the deeper erudition perhaps of Adams, the more profound, the more wrestling with ideas aspect of Adams. But with Jefferson, I mean, you have an ideologue and a ferocious person, but also someone who was a diplomat, who never gave too much away, are there contradictions there, aren't
right,
there?
Right, right. Well, yeah. There's nobody who knew more about more things in America, and I include Franklin in that,
really?
than Jefferson. He just knew about everything. Now, it's whether he knew about anything with the depth, there's certainly Adams knew more history than Jefferson, and he wrestled with his notion of science of politics in a way that Jefferson didn't. But Jefferson is by far the more celebrated of the two men, even by his contemporaries. I mean, Jefferson, at one point, Adams, in their correspondence when they were reconciled, asked Jefferson, how many letters do you get in a year? And Jefferson, this is, I think, 1820, he says, well, I get 2,000-something. And Adams is kind of stunned by that because he gets 200 and something. So
Jefferson was always more popular.
He's in a different celebrity league. He's corresponding with scientists in Europe and with the Tsar of Russia. There's nothing like that for Adams. Adams is just not as well known and is not in that league that Jefferson is. He's already a kind of platonic leader in the eyes of European intellectuals.
That came through very much. He was a superstar.
Definitely.
His relationship with Abigail Adams, fascinating. That they had.
John, you're talking about?
Now I'm talking about Jefferson.
Oh, okay,
yes,
that's right.
I'm talking, of course, we know about the Abigail Adams and her husband.
Right.
But Jefferson and Abigail Adams had this very wonderful friendship correspondence for a while.
When they were in ministers or abroad in Europe, first they were together in France, and then when Adams and the two Adamses go off to London to be minister to London, there's correspondence from between Paris, because Jefferson remains as minister to Paris, and he's corresponding with Abigail and flirting with her
with her.
Well, that's right.
She was flirting with him.
That's right.
Yeah.
And he at one point he says, well, I was going to buy a little statue for the dining room table, for the dining room of Venus. He said, but I thought two Venuses in the same room would be too much. You know, that kind of comment.
Yeah.
It's by today's standards pretty tame stuff, but they really did fall in love with one another, the two families. They've adopted him as a member of the family. He's younger. He's about 8 years younger than John. And he fell in love with that whole family. And they would go off to the museum. He would take John Quincy, the young boy, to a museum while the other family, he would act as a member of the family. And I think that's what happened. They fell really into.
And their conversation, I guess, they had a synergy
very intimate,
there.
Right.
Yeah, and so then the falling out
that
happened.
That was very, very serious.
And it was painful to both of them.
Right.
So could you explain a little bit about that, why they fell out, and then how they reconciled?
Well, they fell out over politics. Jefferson is very much a radical Republican. The Republican Party becomes the opposition party to the Federalists, which is the party of the administration. Neither of them were like parties today. They didn't accept the legitimacy of each other, and they certainly didn't see themselves as permanent parties. First of all, the government never saw itself, the administration never saw itself as a party. They're the government. The Republicans did see themselves as a party only because they were faced with a threat from monarchists. Mm. And the Jeffersonians legitimately feared a monarchical takeover. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the Federalists feared that the Jeffersonians were going to allow France to invade and with
we
the fifth
would be
column.
French.
And we would be Frenchified.
Yeah. Frenchified.
Right, exactly, because Napoleon was doing that all over Europe, mm-hmm. invading Holland, creating the Bavarian Republic, invading Italy, invading Germany, putting up these puppet republics. Well, the threat was that Napoleon and his army were going to invade the United States. That was a serious, legitimate fear that, mm-hmm. that many people had in 1798-99. So that was part of it. But the humiliation of losing the election. Now, Jefferson himself never said anything face-to-face to Adams, and Adams never said anything to Jefferson. But they knew what they thought. Their followers were...
Those letters that other people wrote.
Right.
I found that fascinating, the way, you know, and they would pass along the gossip
so
that the other had said.
And so they knew what each of them was being said about them, and that was devastating. But Adams was just furious at Jefferson.
And yet they reconciled eventually.
Well, I think that was due to the work of Benjamin Rush. Adams's passions faded in time. I mean, it took a while. We're talking 12 years.
Yeah.
From 1800 to 1812. There was a brief moment in 1804 where Abigail writes a letter of condolence to Jefferson, in which she says, "I'm sorry you lost your daughter." She knew that daughter because she had hosted her in London when she was just a kid. And so she expresses this sympathy. And Jefferson responds very favorably. He thinks that maybe this is going to be an opening, but he makes a terrible mistake. He says, "Well, look, I only have one thing that bothered me about your husband's administration, and that was the appointment of the midnight judges." You know, all these judges that were appointed.
Yes.
After Adams had lost the election in November, mm-hmm. in those days, the president didn't take office till March. So it was a long period. And in that period, the Federalists passed legislation and made appointments, including all these judges, 16 judges, plus John Marshall as the Justice of the Supreme Court. Well, he should never have said that, because that just sent Abigail off into a tirade against...
And then they were, and they actually never reconciled.
Then Jefferson tried to respond and explain, and he must have wondered, because then Abigail comes back even more vicious, and he must have wondered, what have I done? And he finally just stops it, and he feels that that's the end. And in fact, when the reconciliation occurs with John, he tells Rush, who mm-hmm. is acting as an intermediary, "Look, I don't want Mrs. Adams involved in this at all, because she and I don't get along." It was sad because they had been so close. Mm-hmm. But it's really Rush. It's 2 years he works at this, and he just keeps bringing back messages to each of them. They love you. He loves
that
you.
That is such a wonderful story. That's going to have to be put on film. Well, you know, I want to, because we don't have that much time, I want to quote the last lines of your book, and it connects to what we've been talking about, where you write, "To be an American is not to be someone, but to believe in something. And that something is what Jefferson declared. That's why we honor Jefferson and not Adams." That's a very interesting way to end the book. Can you elaborate as we...
Well, it's the Declaration of Independence. Mm. All men are created equal. A very powerful statement.
Yes.
That's what Lincoln grabs hold of. And he uses it to justify his opposition to the South and to the extension of slavery. And he's the one who really rescues Jefferson. He says, all honor to Jefferson, and he makes Jefferson the hero. And that's why Jefferson is celebrated in a way that Adams is not. Monticello is a World Heritage Site visited by hundreds of thousands of people every year. And he has a monument. Jefferson has a monument right off the mall on the tidal basin. A magnificent monument. FDR erected it. There's no monument.
And that's because of the idealism of that notion that he put forward, even though in so many ways he was a hypocrite.
Well,
You don't like that word.
Hypocrite, yes, yeah. That's true. He is disingenuous, it's irritating, and historians don't like him for that reason, because they know he's saying one thing. He also was obsessed by politeness.
Yeah.
So he would say something to somebody, but then the next day to someone else, he's running that person down. So he's two-faced. He's disingenuous. And historians who know the score, because they read the letters, don't like him for that reason. But the public generally does, because of so many other things. As I say, nobody knew more about more things than Jefferson.
Well, I think you've done a good job explaining him in all his complexity, as well as Adams. I wish we could go on further. This has been a wonderful interview. I feel really honored to have you here today.
I'm glad to be here.
Okay, and thank you for joining us today at the Drexel Interview. Mm-hmm.